Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. In 1996, the League of Ukrainian Canadians and the Ukrainica Research Institute initiated a program called Historical Memory, Historical Truth, which includes three important areas. The study of the Cossack era, with the Baturyn Project being the centerpiece, the study of the Holodomor, and the study of the Ukrainian National Liberation Movement, 1917 to the present time. And the League and Ukrainica have sponsored many important projects for our community over all of these years. All are Canadian-based and all fall within the parameters of these three important areas. And now our evening's lecture. Dr.Volodymyr Mezentsev is a specialist in medieval and modern Ukrainian and Byzantine archaeology, history, architecture, and art, and the author of 276 publications on these subjects. He completed his postdoctoral studies at the Ukrainian Research Institute at Harvard University. Dr. Mezentsev was a research associate with the Institute of History at the National Academy of Sciences of Ukraine, KU, and later with the Pontifical Institute of Medieval Studies at the University of Toronto. Presently, he is a research associate of CIUS, Canadian Institute of Ukraine Studies, responsible for the Canada-Ukraine Baturyn Archaeological Project. His areas of research have included Ukrainian Baroque architecture and decoration, as well as the influence of Byzantine and West European arts on Ukraine Rus'. He has taught graduate and undergraduate courses on Ukrainian medieval art, on Byzantine, Eastern Christian, and Ukrainian church architecture, and on Slavic civilization at the University of Toronto, the Metropolitan Andrei Shevtichky Institute at St. Paul University in Ottawa, and at the Summer School of the Ukrainian Catholic University in Lviv. Dr. Mezentsev has participated in many archaeological excavations and architectural field investigations of medieval and early modern sites and monuments in Ukraine, Poland, Norway, Greece, Turkey, Bulgaria, and Italy. In 2001, he organized the Canada-Ukraine Archaeological Expedition, conducting annual excavations in Baturyn. He's the executive director of the CIUS Baturyn Project, dealing extensively with its publications, logistics and promotion in Canada and the United States. He is also the producer and co-author of scripts for three documentary films on the history and antiquities of Baturyn in English and Ukrainian. His films have been shown several times on television programs in Canada, the United States, and Ukraine, as well as on YouTube. In 2009, the President of Ukraine awarded Dr. Mezentsev the Order of Merits for his significant contribution to the research and preservation of the historical and cultural heritage of Baturyn. Please welcome Dr. Volodymyr Mezentsev.
Thank you so much, Mr. Orostetsev, for your kind presenting me. And thank you so much for all of you who come in for my presentation today. I would like to be happy as every year to share for you, to share with the Ukrainian community of Toronto the results of our historical and archaeological excavations in Baturyn. But it is my pleasure first to thank to our sponsor of this presentation. This is a Ukrainica Research Institute, and Mr. Orestetsev is the president of that. And also League of Ukrainian Canadian, Mr. Orestetsev is executive director of this organization. They both sponsor my presentation in Toronto for 18 years. And I wish also to acknowledge that the sponsor of the Ukrainian Canadian Baturyn Archaeological Project is Canadian Institute of Ukrainian Studies of the University of Alberta, Pontifical Institute of Medieval Studies at the University of Toronto, and the Ukrainica Research Institute in Toronto. And I wish to thank also to a few benefactors, important benefactors of the Baturyn Project, who supported this project last year particularly. This is Pani Olenka Neric, Pani Holina Kudla, and a member of his family. Her son is present with us today. And actually the full list of all our benefactors is published every year in our annual booklet, which is two booklets for 2 years is presented today, and you can get it from Mr. Orest. And also in Homin Ukraini, the very few actually are, newspapers now can publish the, thanks to the private contributor and donors. And I also would like actually now to proceed with our presentation. Mr. Orst, we can switch off light. Mm-hmm. Yes. Okay. The topic of our presentation today is Pylyp Orlyk's coat of arms, seals of the Cossack elite, and other archaeological finds at Baturyn in 2017, last year. You can see here the participatory excavation in Baturyn last summer. Basically, our partner in Ukraine is Chernihiv National University, and students and archaeologists from this university, this is representing bulk of our expedition. And also, participants are students from the University of Lviv. Altogether, it was about 45-50 people. And as always, I briefly give you a sketch of the history of Baturyn and its tragic destruction in 1708. As you see, this is our most recent map plan of Baturyn. It's located in upper high bank of the River Seine, which is tributary of Dysna. And in the late 11th century, Chernihiv princes constructed fortress here, which was southeastern outpost of Chernihiv Principality during the Mongol invasion of Rus-Ukraine. Mongols destroyed totally this fortress, and it was probably, you can say, renewed in nearly 17th century. So during the period of control of Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth of the left bank Ukraine, royal administration and the magnates, they rebuilt Baturyn fortress, actually on the site of the princely fortress. This is its citadel. It was area about 1.5 hectares. Hectare is 100 by 100 meters. In the 30s and 40s of 17th century, royal administration also constructed this another line of fortification, which we called Fortress of Baturyn, with an area about 26 hectares in area. So the castle, which were built in 1625, it became like a citadel, inner fortress. And with the beginning of the Khmelnytsky Revolution, Cossacks freed Baturyn from Polish administration and the garrison, and in 1669, Baturyn became the capital of the Cossack Hetman state. Hetmans Demyan Nagagrishny, Ivan Samoilovich, and Ivan Mazepa, they established their residence in Baturyn, main principal residence. And time of Mazepa reign, it's 1687 until its destruction in 1708. This is a time of the most prosperity of Baturyn, and actually it's the suburbs were also populated in late 17th, early 18th century, and it's also stretched along the high river bank. Mazepa established his suburban residence in a suburb of Honcharivka, we will discuss it later, fortified residence, and altogether actually populated area of Baturyn, its agglomeration with the suburbs, the country, estates of Cossack elite and so on, we estimated up to 100 hectares in area, which could be with population of about 20,000, which is quite a substantial town in Ukraine of 17th-18th century. And this is the aerial view of Baturyn from the site of from the river Seine. And this is the citadel or castle, which were restored in 2008 with support of President Yushchenko. And a fortress encompassed this area on a field site, 26 hectares in area. This is aerial view of Baturyn fortress, citadel, on the field site. So you see they restored by 2008 the residence of the Hetman before Mazepa. It's Demian Nagorishnyman Samoilovich, church of the Holy Resurrection commissioned by Mazepa, wooden church. This is masonry structure. Here it is draw well and the treasury house, and here you can say the monument cross monument dedicated to the victims of Baturyn tragedy. You can see here the treasury house and the draw well on this site, and you can see that fortification line, all of these fortifications and structures inside, they were excavated, and the restoration were reconstruction made on the base of our archaeological excavation and research. So this is as typical for the medieval fortification of left bank Ukraine. All of these fortifications are very traditional, typical for the Cossack, you can say, fortification. They consist of the moa. In the case of the citadel, they riveted with the locks, which reinforced the fortification. And also it consists of the earthen mud and the wooden wall with the towers and the gate. So they actually built of the squared log, which called in Ukraine brusi. And please pay attention that this is wooden fortification, typical for medieval left bank Ukraine. But by the time of late 17th century, in the special 18th century, they were obsolete. Basically, the lower part is filled with clay. Then they can withstood more or less to the artillery shelling. But there are still very vulnerable places, sites. This is towers and gates, because they couldn't be filled with clay. There is a passage, as well as an upper gallery protecting the defenders. It's called, they should have access to the loopholes, so there couldn't be filled with clay. Planning is also obsolete. Mazepa built much more advanced and contemporary fortification for his country residence, Gonchirivka, which I will discuss later. This is a portrait of Mazepa, which considered to be one of the most reliable. We use it all the time because of that. This is of 1700. And of course you know well Mazepa, that his prosperous, his successful reign, which lasted 21 years, much longer, and the position for the Hetman state was much more stable politically, economically, than any other Hetman of Ukraine. And of course he constructed a lot of structures in Baturyn. We will discuss some of them. But I wish to stress that Mazepa was, you can say, the most known and the most respected in the West among all Ukrainian hetmans. This is a German edition called Die Europäische Fama, which are dedicated to the famous ruler of Europe in early 18th century. It was published in Leipzig in 1706, and Mazepa, there is chapter dedicated to Mazepa with his portrait. So he was respected. Even she referred in a 1707, 1708 as a Prince Mazepa, because in 1707 he was granted with a title, a royal title of the Prince of the Holy Roman Empire by the Kaiser of Habsburg Empire. So in Austrian, German, French, and English sources, he could be referred as a Prince Mazepa. You know well that Mazepa, in 2 or 3 years before his uprising of 1708, he starts secret relation with the Polish king Stanislaw Leszczynski, who was ally of Charles XII. As a very experienced politician, he foresee that in the course of reform of Peter the First, as well as the course of the Great Northern War, which started from 1708 until 1721, the chances for autonomy of Ukraine to be preserved is very scant. And for the Borosian Cossacks to preserve their privileges and rights, it's also all of this forced him to look for the dominion of Swedish Empire, which considered to be most powerful in this time. And as many people in Europe, Mazepa strongly believed in the victory of Charles XII of Sweden over Peter the First. So in the 22nd of October, he left Baturyn with about 3,000 Cossacks and his Serduki, member of his guard, and they crossed this now, and near Novgorod Siversky, he met Charles XII with his camp, Swedish camp, who already entered Chernihiv Oblast, north of Chernihiv Oblast, in area of Novgorod Siversky. On 26th of October, he arrived, and in 2 days he was received officially by Charles XII. They concluded a political and military alliance between Cossack Hetman State and Swedish Empire, and definitely Mazepa insisted as soon as possible Swedish troops move to Baturyn and help it actually to survive the siege, and it was beautiful perspective for Swedish army to winter in Baturyn, to have a military base. The army was totally exhausted. Swedish army in the turn of 17th and 18th century considered to be the best in Europe. This is cavalry shots from the army museum in Stockholm. And Charles XII, he himself was a cavalry officer. So, unfortunately, it's happened that the Swedish army takes so long. They spent too much days to cross the Dnieper with the battles in three locations. And in fact, they landed in the south bank of the Dnieper, which were about 60 kilometers from Baturyn, only on November 5th. And coming to Baturyn on November 10th, this was too late. Peter First, he realized that Mazepa joined Swedish army, Swedish camp, and he sent General Alexander Menshikov with 15,000-20,000 Russian soldiers to destroy Baturyn as soon as possible by all means before arrival of Swedish and Ukrainian army. He realized Swedes planned to have military base in Baturyn, and on the 1st of November already, Menshikov start storming Baturyn. This is how Baturyn's fortress can look in November of 1708. It was extremely cold winter, long and cold with early snow. And first storm in November 1st was total and successful. According to Swedish sources, Russian troops, they lost over 3,000. And Menshikov actually lost hope that he will take Baturyn by storm, and he started to retreat to Luhiv, where it was at this time residence of Peter the Great. He crossed Seim, and he was marching back to Luhiv. Unfortunately, it was a local traitor in Baturyn, Preluki regiment colonel Ivan Nis. And he disclosed to Menshikov location of secret tunnel leading to the heart of Baturyn fortress, to the citadel. Probably it's lead to the basement of this resurrection church from the side, from the bank of the Seine. Archaeologists discovered this this secret tunnel by 2008. At how he looks, it was just dug up in a clay yellow subsoil, and according to Russian sources, they coming back on November 2nd, and at night they start storm from both sides. Probably some detachments penetrated to the citadel from this tunnel, but they also stormed Baturyn with artillery, shelling the fortress, and it, according to their sources, in a 2 hour, garrison was destroyed. In Mazepa left only 6,000-7,000 in Baturyn because he should take some troops, 3,000 to Swedish camp, and it was not sufficient. Swedish sources also reported that 1,000 Cossacks, when they realized that the Russian break into the fortress, they escaped and escaped from encircling and reached Mazepa. They brought information that Baturyn fortress fell. And so when Russian soldiers, they destroyed Baturyn garrison, it's remained about, according to estimation of historian, 5,000-6,000 military, a member of the military personnel, Cossacks and Serdukis, and they destroyed also civilian population, totally whatever remained in Baturyn. It's estimated to 5,000-6,000. Altogether in Baturyn, after it was occupied by Russian troops, they stay maybe there for 2-3 days, it's perished about 14,000 Ukrainians. This is picture, in the previous my presentation I show you some picture about destruction of Baturyn. Now I would like to share with you, this is picture of destruction of Estonian town of Narva in 1705 by Russian troops, and you see marauding Russian soldiers actually attacking, looting, and many kind of violence of the civilian population, breaking into churches and so on. In Baturyn it was even worse. By the order of Peter I, Baturyn should, you can say, serve to demonstrate the hard, high price to be paid for disloyalty to the Tsar. That was his order. And Menshikov completed enthusiastically, massacring population with no quarter for women, children, elderly, and clergy. So, archaeological excavations probably collaborated information of lore and written sources about the full destruction of Baturyn with its population, and also supplemented the picture. So in all cemeteries we excavated in within the fortress, there is layer of which could be dated to the 1708 destruction. This is victims in a citadel. There is about 100 of skeletons were excavated before restoration of the fortress in 2008, and among them 90% is children, 10% is women. They probably looking seeking for refuge in a citadel during the storm and shelling, you know. And they perish here, sharing the destiny of the Cossacks. Cossacks officers were brutally executed, they were quartered, impaled, hanged, and broken in the wheel, according to the popular in the Russian Empire execution of this time. And some of them, the highest officer, were only arrested and taken to Lukiv and then executed in the presence of Peter I. And not all of civilians were massacred. Many of them perished from the fire. After looting, Baturyn was burned. And this is also a picture from the citadel. You see the small grave. This is children. This is example of picture of person who were not actually buried, because before it was what we find is it's burial of the family members of the Cossacks who with Mazepa actually joined Swedish camp. They could not leave Baturyn. Swedes could not stay there. That was totally destroyed. But they should come in back and bury family members. Well, then we can find the skeletons. The corpses which remain in the streets, and they definitely, according to sources, were full of bodies, and nobody buried them. They're not preserved, because Baturyn was deserted for about half a century, and if they were not buried in the ground, they disappear. So when we excavated many burned dwellings, and this is the grain pit, we can find skeleton like that. This is a youngster who tried to find refuge there, and of course perished from smoke and gases during the during this destruction, this conflagration of Baturyn. And as I said, half a century Baturyn was in desert. There was even ban to renew Baturyn. And only last hetman of Ukraine, of left bank Ukraine, Kirill Rozumovsky, you see his portrait. This is copy, contemporary copy of the early 19th century piece. He obtained permission from a press, Elizaveta Petrivna, to restore Baturyn and actually restore its status as a Cossack hetman capital. Before it was temporary in Glukhiv, and he moved it to Baturyn. This is a tomb of last Ukrainian hetman. It was established, it is beautiful marble piece, established on a place of his grave. It was in a masonry resurrection church, his mausoleum. And it was totally destroyed by the Bolshevik in 1928, and they actually looted, plundered the burial, and we still don't know whether remnants, remains of last hetman survived there. Hetman Kirill Rozumovsky was a famous reformer. He was very industrious, a successful businessman. Even, as you know, his reign was not so long as Mazepa. He, in 1764, autocratic Empress Catherine II abolished Cossack Hetman state, even before destruction of Zaporozhian host, and she forced Rozumovsky to resign. So during his tenure, he performed himself a perfect reformer of the Cossack Hetman state, its army, its judicial system, and so on. That's what's exactly intimidated Catherine II, and she abolished Cossack Hetman state. But even later, he spent his last 10 years of his life, and he died in 1803 in Baturyn. And he privatized Baturyn, and he was very generous patron of Baturyn. So he rebuilt it, repopulated, and it was second, you can say, time of revival after Mazepa in Baturyn. After his death, Baturyn declined, and during Soviet era, it even lost urban features. It became just ordinary village, even thanks to only thanks to Yushchenko, he patronized Baturyn, and he granted its official status, administrative status of a town. But in fact, it's remained agrarian settlement. So Kirill Rozumovsky built many palaces all around Ukraine. Only few of them survived, and actually the best in Baturyn. This is his first palace. Residence of the Hetman, built in 1715 by the design of Italian architect Antonio Rinaldi in late Baroque style. This is, we know its location, it's on a, its foundation is of brick, and the wall is wooden. It was fashion building wooden late Baroque palaces in the Russian Empire in this time, and there is a chapel in a wings, and this structure, the same as second one, were demolished in 19th century. In 19th century, before communist era, this is picture Discovery of the last year. Associate of the Baturyn Historical Preserve, this is our important partner in Ukraine, they discover in early 20th century publication this beautiful picture of Baturyn. It's probably suburbs. With the residence of Kirill Razumovsky, this is with the wings and court church and a park with a fence, and there is two pavilions. It's definitely another structure, and this person in Baturyn maintained this was a suburban residence, and we still could not discover it archaeologically. Only then it will be more, you can say, precisely decide whether it's really structure of 18th century, whatsoever. But anyway, it's not survived the 19th century. It was renovation. The only this palace, the best palace, and the latest foundation of Kirill Razumovsky survived to the present with restoration, thanks to Yushchenko as a president of Ukraine. He invested in its restoration, and it was completed. This is the largest museum now of Baturyn Historical Preserve. You can see the main elevation. It was designed by the famous Scottish architect Charles Cameron in 1799. And it's include 50 rooms and halls. I would like to stress that it is most ambitious structure of Razumovsky and the only one piece of Charles Cameron in Ukraine, and its style, Palladian neoclassicism, is considered to be the best piece in this style, one of the best pieces in the world, in the worldwide. So I just believe myself that this structure Razumovsky built in late of his years, after the death of Catherine II, she died in 1796, so he felt himself much more free, and it's embody, you can say, the ambition, the ruling ambition of Hetman, who was forced to resign, but he never accepted that he lost Hetman's power. This is a symbol of glory of the Ukrainian Hetmans, what I believe he embodied, and it is the only one structure, government structure, residential structure of Ukrainian Hetman in Ukrainian territory, which come down to us. Not in Chigirin, nor in Hluchiv, nothing in Hadych, nothing survived, only in Baturyn. Now I will discuss with you residence of Mazepa in Honcharivka suburb. This is an aerial view. This is also an upper bank of the River Seine, and its territory occupied 9 hectares. And in this forest, there is actually now located only the 2.5 hectare of populated area, where the palace and the church, whatever we excavated, are located. The rest of the territory of 9 hectare were not settled by the time of destruction in 1708. Possibly Mazepa planned to make it a new district here, but he has not enough time for that. And he completed powerful fortification, only made of earth. This is a rampart in the forest with the bastions, and the rampart and the moat. And this is how the rampart, the bastions looks like in the present time. Of course, it was much more shapy and higher in the late 17th century. This residence constructed before 1700, in late 90s of 17th century. So it existed only less than 10 years until 1708, and it was destroyed. And this is the reconstruction. It is our specialist in fortification from Chernihiv Historical Museum. He doing this reconstruction, and we will publish in our new booklet in June his final version. This is not a final will be in color, And you can see how this, you can say, quite extensive fortress of 90 hectares looks like. As I said, only along the slopes of the high river bank, it was populated area with the palace, with the this masonry palace, wooden church. This is barracks for the guard, draw well, and this is a living area probably for student, for servants or and guests. Please pay attention to the configuration of this fortification. They're not rounded, they're not circular like obsolete medieval fortress of Baturyn. They are polygonal, with projecting earthen bastions. And according to this specialist in fortification, he believed Mazepa designed that fortress on a model of the most advanced at this time, contemporary fortresses of Holland, which considered to be the best. They were only earthen. No masonry, no wooden walls were used. That was the, you can say, last response of fortification toward the progressing artillery in the 17th century. This is another, you can say, more latest version with the showing you that area were completed. There were fields, they were grove, birch bark grove, there were garden, beyond the ravine it was Goncharivka suburb, and here is the floodland and so on. This specialist in fortification, they make a preliminary reconstruction of the bastions. Please pay attention, they are also polygonal, faceted. When the cannonball affect this wall, they always come in under the angle, and it's not so destructive for fortification. There is no wooden fence, but there is a parapet with the ports for the cannons. They, of course, may be used like in, typically for this time, at the time of Northern, Great Northern War, baskets with the clay or earth. And this is spiked logs, which were simply, instead of the wall, established over the rampart. Another bastions, view from the top. Well, spiked logs could be also put before the mound. And this is, you can say, Swedish picture of the contemporary fortification for the time of Great Northern War. This is a section of earthen rampart with a mound, no any fence, just spiked logs, whatever, four cannons, four musketeers. Picture, it's also from Army Museum in Stockholm, my picture. Looks how in 17th century artillery successfully destroyed any medieval masonry, stone castles, fortresses, and so on. They provide no longer refuge for artillery shelling. This is Dutch fortification, whatever Mazepa can be familiar with and imitate. Look, there is only earthen ramparts and moats and so on. Several echelons of the defense, how the parapet for the cannons looks like, only earthen, polygonal projecting bastions, this is sections for the mod and rampart, only wooden. That's what Mazepa rely on this fortress, possibly, because the written and archaeological sources confirm that the fortification, earthen and wooden fortification of Baturyn were neglected in Baturyn during his reign. There's complaints for that. The moat was filled with the clay even before destruction in 728. Of course, he has many projects, he built a lot of churches and so on, but he maybe believed that that his fortress in Goncharivka will be provide more better protection. Unfortunately, it was not the case. I believe that the forces remaining in Baturyn, 6,000-7,000, it was not sufficient to divide for two fortresses. They probably brought defenders of Goncharivka to Baturyn and they perished with others in the fortress. Except of Mazepa's residents, nothing were to defend in Anchirivka. While in Baturyn fortress, there were arsenals, there were provisions, there were granaries prepared by Mazepa for Swedish army to winter and so on. They should concentrate that, and they all perish in the fortress of Baturyn. So archaeological sources provide no information that there are any military action in Anchirivka. Yes, Russian troops occupied Gancharivka, they looted palace, they burned it, and that's it. And it ceased to exist, never be restored. Palace of Mazepa in Gancharivka, this is my reconstruction. Of course, it was destroyed, but we restored it with many different sources. And this was structure of three story with a mansard. 20 by 15 meters in size, and it was designed, I believe, this is my main object of research, it was designed in a style of mature Central European Baroque. It was destroyed in 1708 and never be restored. A wooden church reconstruction offered by this specialist in fortification, he also quite a keen specialist in wooden architecture of Mazepa time. We excavated remnants of the church. It's completely wooden. Then it was really scrupulous work to restore it outline. It's a layout. It's hypothetical reconstruction, and of course the reconstruction of this volume is also hypothetical. But it's based not only on a layout, what we discover, but also on a analogies of Mazepa's churches, wooden churches. He built a lot, about 50 churches altogether with the restoration. Some of them survived, wooden churches in early 18th century in Chernihiv land. So they consist of, it's three-partita church, as it was typical for this time, with a, it's called babinets, women area and children. There were a custom for some time in Ukraine, women and children, they attended liturgy separately from a man. Men staying here in the naos. This is what's called in Ukrainian vosmirik. This is octagonal volume naos with the Baroque dome and a lantern. And this is altar part, which was faced. So they were also, like the same as Baturyn fortification, built of brusi, squared logs, and only then on a face, it was faced with the plank, so definitely it was a log structure. So it survived destruction, but it was destroyed, it was by itself, it was deserted and robbed and so on, and it ceased to exist in the 60s of 18th century during Razumovsky era. That's what the comments said. Now I will present you results of our excavation of residence of future, famous future Hetman Pylyp Orlyk. This is his contemporary portrait as a Hetman. He was a Hetman in exile from elected in 1710 and until his death 1742. With a mace as a Hetman and in a mantle as a Hetman and so on. But when Pylyp Orlyk start his career in Baturyn, he was not yet a Hetman, but only a scribe, a military scribe at the military chancellery. So that was, you can say, he was in the rank of the Cossack officers, but not high-ranking official. So later, before Mazepa, about 1707, he became very close to Mazepa, his, you can say, personal secretary, and he was in the rank of Chancellor General. Then it was, you can say, rich position, he became rich, but not before. His residence was beyond the fortress, which probably was cheaper. This is beginning of its excavation, and this we discover his foundation of his dwelling, which has masonry, brick foundation of broken brick supporting the wooden walls. So like typical chata dwelling, Ukrainian dwelling, it was wooden, but we know that it has at least two or three heating stoves, decorated with glazed ceramic tiles, terracotta tiles, And because they were burned, we can maintain that this house of Orlyk, that it was also burned and destroyed in 1708. To give you an example how looks the wooden structure of 18th century looks like, I suggest this wooden residence of the sister of Razumovsky. She was married with the Kievan colonel Yuhim Darahan, and that was their estate in a village Pokorshina near town of Kozarets in Chernihiv Oblast. Very few wooden structures from the Hetman time coming to us. This is one. Unfortunately, it's not restored at all. But the basement was masonry, wall were wooden, as the same as this porch. It was very, you can say, luxuriously decorated interior before Bolshevik Revolution, with beautiful tiled heated stoves all disappear after revolution in early 20th century. So to give you another example, I show you a large Ukrainian chata in the Mamayeva Sloboda. This is beautiful ethnographic museum within Kyiv. And this is style used actually in northern Ukraine in a forest zone, in the same as in Chernihiv. So it looks like typical chata mazanka coated with clay, but in fact it is built of logs, these bruises. And it's only then it was plastered and whitewashed and looks like a chata mazanka. But in fact it was wooden, a log structure. Now of course it is country style with a straw roof, but it could be wooden planks or wooden tiles used in a Baturyn for the, because it was urban settlement. And this is interior in Mamayeva Sloboda for Ukrainian rich chata with heating stoves faced with the glazed ceramic tile. In this case it's monochrome. And also decoration of the, you know, typically plates and dishes, glazed ceramic, and how the interior could look like in a rich Ukrainian chata of the early modern time. And this is more richer structure which survived to the present in Baturyn, the unique structure in Baturyn of late 17th century which escaped the destruction because it belonged to the General Judge Vasil Kochubey. He was traitor of Mazepa, and maybe he has amnesty in the time of destruction of Baturyn. In addition, his house residence located beyond the fortress, so it's escaped destruction. And Kochubey was already in 1700 general judge. It means he was the highest ranking official. It was a richer person to compare with Orlyk of this time. It's called in Ukrainian Kamenitsa. Kamenitsa because it's all built of brick. It has a vaulted brick basement and ground floor also vaulted. It was renovated in 19th century, but with this renovation come down to us. This is also museum, one of museum of Baturyn Historical Preserve. Artistic reconstruction of his household or estate of Vasil Kochubey with his kamenitsa, wooden church of the introduction of the Virgin, some service structure and so on. And in the time of Razumovsky, he bought from Kochubey this residence, this estate. He has his own beautiful palaces, but he require administrative structure. And he built in this area one wooden and two masonry structural brick, which we excavated starting from for 2 years already. So this is a foundation of the largest structure. It's quite powerful, in a sense, it's more than 1 meter thick, the same, you can say, it's the same thickness as a Mazepa Palace. And its size was close to Mazepa Palace in Hanchurivka. It was 20 by 13 meters, while Mazepa was 20 by 15 meters, just a bit more narrow. And according to our finds of glazed ceramic tiles for the heating stove, we can say it was 3-4 heating stoves. This kind of foundation, quite powerful to maintain, to support two or three masonry floor. And why this give me a reason to give you, this is cameras, chambers in a level of the basement, inner walls of this structure. And beyond of that, it was smaller masonry structure, brick structure, which still only beginning of excavation, we cannot say nothing about that. But the larger structure could be probably similar to the to this house, which is chancellery of the, you can say, Kozagetman state of time of Rozumovsky of 50-60s of the 18th century, which survived in the town of Kozelets. As you see, this is two-story building, also about maybe 20 meters long, and it is this smaller elevation, which decorated typically with the pilasters, rustic, with this, it's in the plaster, these blocks created, as well as the sandrix over at plant bombs with a shell. That's typical decoration of late Baroque or Rococo, dominating in mid 18th century. That's what you can say government structure of Rozumovsky era, in the time of second revival of Baturyn, could look like. In Baturyn, this building was bigger. Unfortunately, Kochubey's family, they restored the possession of this residence of Kochubey in the 19th century, and they demolished all the building of Rozumovsky, the only Kochubey's house survived, which I showed to you. So in a bigger structure, it was decorated, the stove tiles were decorated with these beautiful tiles, and this was the richest. This was probably import from Holland, decorated with so-called Delft blue, cobalt dark blue color, with some artistic painting. It's handmade, and in Rozumovsky palaces there are many ovens and fireplaces were decorated like that. It's possibly he has an office in this building which has a richer heating stove. The whole intact tile, that's, I believe, local imitation of Dutch tile. It was most fascinating. And you see, they also imitated locally in Baturyn. This is local Delft blue, cobalt color, how they can reproduce it, with some Rococo, late Baroque decoration. And that could be another separate, they cannot mix this. It was separate heating stoves. And the third, at least, what we discover, or maybe two more, they were decorated with these plain tiles, devoid of any decoration, any painting, any relief, with a color of white, enamel, yellow, this is apple green, and brown, and maybe beige. That's colors used in the Rozumovsky era, and he was, as I said, he constructed several manufacturer in Baturyn, producing bricks, producing tiles, producing decorative kitchen utensils and dishes and so on. So that could be really local production, and Rozumovsky started it from 1750s, just from the first time of his rule in Baturyn. Now we will show you the best finds from the last season, last summer excavation. Every year we archaeologists discovered about 11 to 15 coins, and basically it's silver and copper, Polish, Lithuanian, Russian on a second place. One or two, three occasions was finds of Turkish coins, mangirs, copper coins, and in this case I show you three coins from Swedish Empire. The two coins upstairs, this is shillings of the Queen Christina Vasa. She reigned in Sweden from 1632 to 1654. And she was one of the most famous rulers of Europe in this time. This time was the Zenith of Swedish Empire. They control northern German lands, also eastern Baltic, including Finland, Estonia, and Latvia, which called Livonia this time. And actually, in Riga, capital of Livonia, Latvia, they minted these shillings. And the lower one, it was solidus, also silver, minted in Swedish Livonia. So this is evidence, archaeological evidence of cultural and commercial contacts of Baturyn with the Swedish Empire in definitely time before destruction of 1708. And now I show you the signet ring, a quite unique find in Baturyn, a signet ring of bronze with the glass insert bearing the seal. This is a small seal, and this is enlarged impression in wakes. How it was actually used for the impression in wakes, as sealing wakes, for the documents especially, and even correspondence. And elite of Baturyn, and as well as many of this time, if there were noble gentry, Ukrainian gentry, they have their coat of arms, and typically they will use as a seal their coat of arms. But if they were not, they were just state officials and Cossack officers or clergy, they also keep in correspondence and documentation, they used as they called non-heraldic seals. This is examples of quite rare non-heraldic seal. And you can see here the depiction, probably it's, I hope it's clear, that it is a wall of the fortress flanked with two towers. And on the top of that, there is image of an eagle and a serpent who coiled around, coiled its body around the serpent. And this is probably better, another version of our sample of impression in the wakes. You can see here again the fortress and the eagle fighting the serpent or a dragon. There is with small legs. I wish to thank to Vasil Sidorenko, he of the Roberts Library, of the Jacek Center in Roberts Library, who helped a lot to Baturyn Project as a consultant and as in a scholarly matter and in bibliographical information. And he is very keen in Byzantine tradition and ecclesiastical art. So that was his probably advice that it's represented scene of this fortress, its symbol of Constantinople Tsargrad. And this is very few analogies. This is golden ring with the, you see, house or fortress with domes or two towers, also with representation of the eagle fighting in the sky over the town of the dragon. This is silver coins with impression in wakes, which probably give a clear vision. It's also schematic. It is very abstract, stylized representation of the fortress with three towers. And on over that, there is flying eagle fighting this dragon. Clearly dragon with the legs, with a crocodile head, and so on and so on. So later, in the course of study, I maintain that it is a Byzantine subject representing the tale about foundation of Constantinople. And Vasil Sidorenko, he was first who suggests that this is analogy. You probably all know from church service, this small carpet, round carpet, which used in the church when church hierarch, especially bishop, he stand on that during the church service. It's called Orlyk, because this representation of the eagle, Over the town, and Sidorenko is right that it is Constantinople representation, stylized representation of Constantinople, and this is tradition from Byzantine church continued in Ukraine. And this picture gives you a realistic vision of the land wall of Constantinople, which were reproduced on this seal. Land wall built in the 5th century by the Emperor Theodosius, and it was very safe protection from 5th century to the time of Turkish Osman storm of Constantinople in 1453. This is a picture of that. And they were only able to break into the Byzantine capital because they used powerful bombards to destroy the gates, to destroy the land wall, and then they were able to occupy the city. Among these slaves, actually, who served for artillery, it was one Russian pilgrim. His name was Nestor Iskander. Iskander, it's a Turkish name for the Alexander. And it is hard to say how, but he became freed. And he came back to Moscow. He was, during pilgrimage, he was enslaved by the Turks and involved in this, in a battle for Constantinople. And he complete his story about the fall of Tsargrad, Constantinople, to the Turks in 1453, in late 15th century. And in this story, he include account on the foundation of Constantinople by the Emperor Constantine the Great. You see his tapestry of the made in Paris in 1625, and by the design of Peter Rubens. And this is representing Constantine the Great. In early 14th century, he founded Constantinople, directed the building. And you see here also representation of the eagle, symbol of imperial power from Roman time, and also it became symbol of church power. And according to Iskander, definitely he take this passage, this story, this tale, from some Byzantine sources, that at the time of the building, from some certain hole, it appear a serpent or dragon. And the eagle attacked the dragon. It's captured dragon, serpent, and brought it to the sky, and they continue combat. But the serpent succeeded to coil it around wings of the eagle, and it fell down. The builders killed serpent, freed eagle, and he flight away. And Constantine the Great, he requested from Orthodox prophets to explain, to interpret this event. And they make a prophecy that it definitely was retrospection from a time of Turkish invasion. That your town, which you built, it will be captured by the Muslims. But because the eagle was freed and its flight away, it symbolized that the Christianity, Orthodox faith, will survive and will be living. And one day it's coming that Christians will recapture Constantinople from the Muslims. So in Moscow, this story was actually illustration of this story with the eagle and serpent over the Constantinople. Was strange, it was popular not in the 15th, 16th century, but in 17th century, time of major expansion of Ottoman Empire, especially in Europe. So in this case, you realize that serpent is symbolizing Islamic faith and eagle is Christianity. And so the fighting, and that was the feature of this popularity of this illustration. In all, in many aspects of visual lights, it was used, but it was also known in the West. Please look here on the margin. Here is a small medallion with depiction of eagle, which is also banded, coiled with the snake. So it was known in the West as well in 17th century, time of fighting the Ottoman Empire the most. and it was definitely known in Byzantine Empire. So this is mosaics of the eagle, you can say, fighting again with the serpent. Mosaic on the wall of the Great Palace of Byzantine Empire. It was founded by Constantine in early 14th century, and it was the major residence of Byzantine Empire until early 11. So totally structure, totally this palace, all this pavilion destroyed by the Turks. But archaeologists discovered this piece, and so that was in early Byzantine time. It was still known well. So whether it's coming to Baturyn from Byzantium as a tradition, from Moscow, because it was, of course, church contacts very intensive. Baturyn is in the borders with a Russian land, and also from the West. But it was people, not gentry, who has no quatuor, but they selected this subject for the seal, which they can use all life or maybe several years, whatsever. But specialists on seals and heraldic, they believe person who use it, they should know the subject, they should know the story. It was most likely educated Cossack officers who know this story of foundation of Constantinople, or it was clergy who know that, or state official. So how the post-Byzantine subject penetrated to Baturyn? And if you wish read more about this, I published January, it was published in a Canadian Byzantine number 29, which you can pick up at the entrance as a report for excavation of last year. So as far as related to Byzantine style. And now I will show you finds of heraldic elements, heraldic symbols. On the site of Orlyk's residence, it was discovered a fragment of this style, and you can see its graphical outline, which could give you probably more understanding of this relief. But we maintain that here is the representation of the mace, but special mace not used by the Getman, but the colonels and maybe some higher ranking state officials. It's called ribbet mace. You see here a picture built on the bottom. Ribbet mace or flanged mace. That's called in Ukrainian shestoper or pirnach. It was symbol of power of colonels. Cossack colonels, hetmans, officers, colonels. There is a banner with wooden shaft of flagstaff, with a piece of the banner weaving around, and how the graphically it was restored, how these elements, banner, and it's another banner, it's called bunchuk, used by the Cossacks and Turks and Tatars. They borrow it from the steppe nomads. This is a horse tail used as a banner on a flagstone. And on the bottom there is probably a cantus leaf typical for the in Baroque style. So how the pirnach looks like? This is from Baturyn Museum, this is from Chernihiv Historical Museum. They were decorative, they were military, but it is also insignia. The same is mace for the hetman, for the colonel it was mace. And maybe like people like the general judge could use it as well, probably. I believe Orlyk as well, when he was official, state higher official, chancellor general. Flags used by the Cossacks. This is, it's called Koroglo, long banner with narrow ends. And this is original flags of the Cossack troops from Khmelnytsky era, which 15 of them in a collection of the Army Museum in Stockholm from time of Khmelnytsky. I just selected one using the narrow end, how the same could be represented on a fragment. Another fragment discovered 2 years before, it's a white animal. First fragment was without any covering, we call it terracotta. It was one heated stove of this style in Orlyk residence. Another was glazed, with glazing tiles.
discovered with animal. And it was discovered 2 years before, and we believe that this is relief, the same as in Mazepa time they use relief in the tiles. In the tile of Rozumovsky it was flat, the same as Dutch tile were flat, just painted. And here is relief. You can say this is a muzzle of the cannon, as we believe. Muzzle of the cannon. Outline can help you. And there is hand weapons used by the Cossacks. And if we, you can say, restore the barrel of the cannon, that could be represented like that, connected with the piece. All of these elements were typical for the decoration of coat of arms in the time of Mazepa especially, and in the time of Orlyk. From Chernihiv Historical Museum, I show you Hetman era cannons produced basically in Gluhiv, produced of bronze, and they very decorated, luxuriously decorated. That's what we use for our reconstruction. And I will show you a few examples of coat of arms of Mazepa decorated with this weapon. Usually cannons were in the bottom. This is gravure, etching of Mazepa, glorifying of 1705 by Ivan Migura. He represented Mazepa among the muses, and he glorified here for his building of the churches and patronizing the culture, education, and so on. This is his typical coat of arms, his anchor-like cross. You can see it more closer with the cannon, normally on the bottom. Then it will be great number of flags, maces, sabers, all kind of equipment, bunchuki, and so on and so on. This is Mazepa coat of arms in the relief. You know, Mazepa patronized a church, and he commissioned several beautifully silver and gilded in casing for the icons, famous miraculous icons. This is the one done for the which he commissioned for the Ilinskaya Mother of God, and it's from Chernihiv. Presently, it's in Chernihiv Historical Museum. This is a representation of his coat of arms. Also surrounded richly with all these decorative weapons. In Ukrainian it's called decorative armatura because the cannon was called armata in 17th-18th century, and this is decorative armatura of the coat of arms. And in Cossack tradition, in 18th century Cossack flags, you will also find decorative weapons. They normally represented Cossack with a musket on a shoulder, like you can see. This is remnants of the flag of the Lubny regiment of mid-18th century, richly decorated with the decorative weapons and cannons and flags and drums and so on, cannonballs. This is contemporary reconstruction of the Zaporozhian host flag, also with the Cossack with the musket, and you see in a contemporary way they represented here weapons as well. In 18th century it was typical. What was atypical? Atypical was representation of the coat of arms on any heraldic emblems in ceramic, in the glazed ceramic tile. Whatever Orlyk done, he was unique. Not before him, not after him, nor in Ukraine, neither in Lithuania, Belarus, or Poland. As far as I know, they lots of representation of coat of arms, heraldic tiles, many, no with weapons for 17th, 18th century. But Orlyk seems like that. He liked that. He liked introduced weapons in his emblems. This is contemporary portrait of Pylyp Orlyk as a Getman and the author of the first Ukrainian constitution of 1710, which called also Bender constitution. There is an underground Bender fortress, Turkish fortress, and this is his coat of arms, which is a small one. We will discuss it later in detail. On the right you can see his seal of the Cossack Getman state and seal of the Zaporozhian host. That was the same because Hetman was head of the Zaporozhian host officially. This is wax seal on the document. You see again, this is Cossack with the musket. This is original seal to give you better vision of that. He used seal of Mazepa time, or Mazepa time from 1687. When Mazepa became hetman, he ordered to make this seal. But specialists in heraldics and specialists on Orlyk's coat of arms, they maintain Mazepa, Orlyk in Sweden. He added decorative weapons to the seal. When he was in exile in Sweden, he made it. Unfortunately, I have known this seal, this symbol of the state, of Cossack Hetman state, with arms. But I have a picture of Orlyk's sealed wakes on a document from Sweden. The red one dated to 1716, and the black one dated to 1719. While he in Sweden, he ordered to make his own, this is his private coat of arms. He was of gentry origin, and his family left from Czech land in 15th century, and then they lived in Poland, Belarus, and Lithuania. This actually, his coat of arms is of Polish origin. It's called Novina, in Ukrainian Polish, news. It's called news. So it's represented figured shield with the crown. On the top there is a legs of knight in armor. And Orlyk added to this typical known in Ukraine and in Poland coat of arms, because other family in Ukraine also share this coat of arms. He added a symbol of power of Hetman, maces. Normal standard maces, as you know, with round head. He added that. He liked to introduce weapons in his emblems. And that is the glazed ceramic tile discovered in 2014 on the site of Orlyk residence, when we realized that this is his residence, site should be excavated. It was first discovery indicated that was Orlyk coat of arms Novina. And you can see here, it is a glazed ceramic tile, but it was burned and the any color could not be traced, color of this glazing. But it was here definitely. And it's represented shield, figured shield, with the cattle handle, that's what emblem, symbols, heraldic symbols, and a sword. It's here is outline, you can see it more clearly. Sword over the cattle handle. Over, we added as a reconstruction to this here from his personal seals, crown and the leg. There is a description of this in a Polish tradition of this coat of arms. They maintained that in 20th century Polish king was imprisoned with his knight, and knight succeeded to freed king for the sake of he cut off his leg. Since this time, a king granted to this family emblem, and then since this time it's Orlyk used that. Here is the palm leaves envelope, this shield, what we reproduced. And here is kind of a typical floral baroque ornamentation with the typical curls and so on, which we supplemented with, we cannot put here, maces as a Hetman, because while he was in Baturyn, this is his earliest emblem, he can use only a ribbit mace as a colonel. Pernach. That we introduced that to make the reconstruction. And we try to compare to whether the other fragment compatible to this gear, and it's appear not all of them, just only one with the cannon is compatible. And another with a fledged mace and the banner, they're smaller. It was terracotta tiles from another heating stove. And that was one stove which was glazed, decorated. It could be, of course, more cannons. It's hard to say, but we have only evidence about one. So now about color. It was glazed. And specialists in Baturyn Kakhli glazed ceramic tiles, they maintain that the tiles discovered in Orlyk's residence are local production. This is Baturyn production, and I show you examples. While Mazepa, as a richer hetman, he used for his stove tiles in the palace best Kievan artist. We discussed it in the past lecture. And that was examples of different color used in Baturyn and the Mazepa time. So you see here, they used dark blue cobalt for the ground. They used yellow and green and white and also light blue. And what colors we can operate? While in the time of Rozumovsky, they used also brown and beige. We don't know about red, but that was the exactly colors used in Mazepa time. And it gives us reason to make hypothetical, of course, hypothetical reconstruction of coat of arm of the of Orlyk with these colors. We have description of Herb Novina. Its shield was blue. The kettle handle was golden. Sword was silver and leg was silver. Of course, crown should be golden. We put as a silver for the maces, ribbed maces, pernachi. Of course, green ornamentation, palm sleeves and so on should be green. And we used for the cannons yellow because they couldn't reproduce brown for the bronze color. And I showed you before the flag restored with yellow, flag of Cossack restored with yellow cannon. So the ground could be dark blue, which it was used. And in the support of that, I show you how the restored hidden stove in a palace of the Hetman on in a citadel before Mazepa time were restored, and they of dark blue color. According to excavations, one stove tile was bottle green, and that was dark blue, cobalt. So you see, this is exactly a glazed ceramic tile on a main elevation on the front. There is heraldic tile. Heraldic tile with a lion's keeping column. That's the enlarged view. So instead of that, if you can imagine, it was introduced, it was inserted to a coat of armor Orlyk, while the background and the major color was blue. That's what we, for now, can imagine a restoration of this style of Orlyk, of this coat of armor Orlyk. And of course, we will still discuss that, and the final version will be published in our new booklet in June. And now I just used to show you that every excavation brought new information, archaeological evidence about destruction of Baturyn. Just beyond the fortification on the Gancharivka Mazepa Villa, there is a wooden dwelling which was excavated. It was destroyed in 1708. There is charcoal signifying that it was burned down, and there is iron cannonball. So Menshikov not only shelled with the artillery fortress, but also it is suburbs of Baturyn. And actually archaeological study of the cemeteries in the suburbs done last year, and it is information in the booklet. I recommend you that there is a cemeteries of with family groups, and it's indication that the whole family during the massacre were perished, different generation. So every year some skeletons discovered, and the last summer it was only a few, but that was from time before Khmelnytsky revolution of the Polish time in Baturyn, Polish control. In the previous 2 years, 2015, 2016, it was discovered about 90 skeletons. They were reburied by the Baturyn Historical Preserve near the Wooden Resurrection Church. Here is a cross over the 90 bodies of the Baturyn residents. In general, this church was designed as a mausoleum of the victims of Baturyn tragedy. And in the basement, there is all coffin with the remnants of the Baturyn residents, whatever in excavation we discovered. Our rule was not taking away the excavated graves. They were filled with ground after investigation. But in many cases, especially in the citadel, when they make construction, they threatened to destroy the cemetery. Then they were taken to the, you can say, storages of the Baturyn Preserve, and in the several occasions they reburied them here. But they still in the basement, they anthropologists, specialists on that, and some archaeologists, they have access to that. So basically whatever they bury in the ground, it was whatever we have no evidence and traces that it is victims. The cross was, you can say, chiseled from a stone imitating the crosses on over the Cossack graves. So they start to build a graveyard around the wooden church, as many churches have. And in the 13th of November every year, the Baturyn Historical Preserve organized a commemoration of the day of destruction of Baturyn, Baturyn tragedy. And since time of Yushchenko of 2005, it started this tradition. First it was on a national level, finally it's getting much more modest. Unfortunately, even since time of Yanukovych, it's coming to, you can say, sponsorship of the Baturyn and its region in the Bakhmach. So some governors from Chernihiv Oblast coming to this event, students and archaeologists coming as well, but normally this is participant about half a thousand every year, residents of Baturyn and neighboring towns who people, you can say, are the heartland of the Hetmanate, Inkonotop, Korob, Nizhen, Sumy, Romny, Bakhmach. People probably who feel more involved in this history and for whom more painful this tragedy of destruction of the Hetman capital. So every year they have this event and it's going for many years. And of course always there is clergy of the Ukrainian Orthodox Church of Kiev and Patriarchate from Baturyn, from Korob and Bakhmach, coming and they serving a memorial service for the victims of Baturyn tragedy, for civilians and Cossacks who perished there. And of course, there is many events, people bringing flowers to the cross, to this mount, a monument of Baturyn tragedy, and there is related concert going on. And I will show you a picture of famous Kobzar and Lyrnik, Alexander Trius. He coming and singing Cossacks, Dumy, ballads, and so on, related to this event. I wish to conclude that Baturyn Historical Preserve, researchers of Baturyn, they were making all things possible that the research, historical, archaeological, architectural, artistic of Baturyn continued, despite of the war in Ukraine. And we also wish to popularize this information and make it known worldly. Not within Ukraine, in the West, about the history and culture of Baturyn capital and about its tragic destruction by the Russian troops in 1798. Thank you so much for your attention. I will be happy to answer any questions.
In the case, I would like to mention that there is a lot of readings in English and Russian in which is for free, and the book that I mentioned for the last year and year previous
in the photograph that you showed us of women and children that were buried, they were laid out. So this was obviously someone had put them in graves at that point. They weren't just fell where they had fallen and left. I'm just trying to understand.
Right. I can tell you about these graves. This graveyard of the original Resurrection Church commissioned by Mazepa in late 17th century. And so in a course of excavation before too late, this graveyard and the palace nearby, they were excavated. So the church was destroyed in 1708 and never renewed. So the graveyard existed from, let us say, from late or mid 17th century. And the upper layer, this is, we attribute to the victims of the Baturyn tragedy. And they have a lot of similar features. I can give you detail. As typical for the military time burials. For example, they are not deep. They are 30, 40 centimeters, all of them. It means they were done, it's much more shallow than normal. But in a time when the earth was frost in November of this cold year, that could be a situation that they have not enough even digging instrument. They can with weapons do this kind. So we believe that whatever we discover in the cemeteries, that was the graves, standard graves. But they were done in the military situation. And if their relatives buried them, they will not bury them in a mass grave, because it's in animals, you know. If they recognize the body, and they definitely were on these sites and find the family members, they buried them normally in Baturyn. It's pretty well specialist in graves they trace. There was strong tendency, trend, to bury relatives to relatives, create like family groups. And sometimes with very great density, but they tended to put, you can say, members or relatives together. So they, it is individual graves. And most likely they have some kind of crosses, and maybe they even succeed to put a name as normal grave, you know, on the name. And we sure that it was victims of that, because in the fillings of these graves, there is remnants of charcoal and bricks, pieces of bricks. So they taken earth when a time when the neighboring palace, masonry palace, was destroyed. It was totally gone. So they taken this, and some pieces penetrated to the fillings of the earth. Then some of them have signs of life and death. In some cases, especially clearly, that there are 10-year-old boy. It's, if you will take a film, there is the film. There is picture of that. That's from 2 or 3 finds. It is on his, in back of his skull, there is, like in the KGB time, NKVD, bullet hole. Bullet hole. So there are the other features, for example, traces of burning. Traces of burning over the skull. It should be very strong temperature that you can say body will be burned up to the bones. So we, in many cases as archaeologists, we miss that. But when anthropologists, specialists on physical anthropology, work on that, then they find many features like that. So all of them, this, they make in photos. I basically show you a few shots. Most, you can say, I believe, are characteristic. But every year we have something new, and every year I show something new. So, but this specific cemetery, we're more sure that in any other cases, because in other cemetery near the Holy Trinity Cathedral, after the destruction of Baturyn, they built on a site of masonry destroyed church, they made wooden. And it's existed until early 19th century, when Razumovsky built his new resurrection church. Then the cemetery moved to his church, and then it was stopped. But then it is hard work for archaeologists to, on the basis of stratigraphical information, to select the layer dated to this 1708. You see, of course, graves could be, the pits could be not of the same depth. They could be different depths, but the level when they started is one equal. So how they trace one layer, you know, and then it's going, so they said, mentioned this feature, culture, whole feelings, should it be, that there is no specifically children's cemetery, no. They're always mixed, but normal percent of children, of course, mortality of kids was huge, huge.
It's 30-40%. On the cemetery, it will be cheaper. In this case, we have 90%. 90%. It is clearly for everybody. This is indication of catastrophe. It could be, of course, epidemia of, you know, there's some kind of disease. But this was not the case. They will not bury victims of disease in the middle of the city, near the palace, and so on and so on. Then, the cemetery around the Resurrection Church has some kind of border before destruction. And we see that the graves with the children going beyond these borders, up to the palace, up to its wall. It will be never be the case if it was peaceful situation before destruction. Never Getman or ever will allow a cemetery near the church going and cover the area up to the wall of the palace. It's abnormal. So they when it was destroyed, it was possible, they used this space. Why so many kids in this area? We believe that it is from medieval time quite common custom that when it was siege or even a special storm, they put, even in the Chronicle of Kievan Rus, there is some princess ordered to people from suburb run to the detainees in the fortress because it was safer. So children and women, they brought that. It was probably their nannies, mothers and grandmothers. It was at several burials when it was with a woman and one kid. It's quite unusual. Children, really, mortality was quite high. But to be buried together at the same time, mother and children will be dying, it is unusual. Even more, we have one woman, she was not a mother, she was 15 years old, and a small kid with her, baby. So that's many, many small things give this reason for the specialist in burials to make this conclusion. This is a victim, all the layer, upper layer, built in this time, they are victims. Whatever is deeper, there are many older people, Cossacks, whatsoever, buried on a depth about 2.5-3 meters from the surface of this time and so on. They are of older age. There is one burial of the priest. There was wooden crypt with rich burial. And it was silver cross there. It's strange that when they robbed it, definitely, the cross probably fell down, this came down to us. But the bonds, when they robbed, they put away from the crypt. So soldiers, marauders, and so on and so on. So there's many different, you see, elements coming together, they make conclusion. And if you're interested about this article, it's in Ukrainian. We published the biggest our collection of articles. It's called Baturinska Starovina, dedicated to the 300th anniversary of Baturyn Project. I have these books if you really need, I can give it. And we have several articles if you specifically interested. There is a specialist, Volodymyr Kovalenko, on the Baturyn tragedy specifically. And this is in English, this is in Ukrainian. And they're all details about archaeological finds of the victims he included there. It was published in Harvard in English in a collection, Poltava 1700. And it's also in Harvard Ukrainian Studies. But I have a copy I can give you if you... Is it an answer for your question? Or?
Yes, thank you.
Yes, please. Please, another question.
After Baturyn fell, the defenders and the inhabitants of Baturyn were left where they died. Now, my question is, where were the Russian dead buried, and how were they buried?
Yeah.
Have they located anything there? Because you mentioned a few thousand of them died.
Yes,
so what happened to them?
They should be buried somewhere, that's true. I can tell you that mass graves could exist, but the specialist in his article, they think about that. First, there was idea that The easiest way to bury, you see, written documents, especially, for example, Historia Rusi, History of Rus people, they maintained clearly that Menshikov had no time and desire to bury the bodies. And they left them in the street for the, you know, birds and animals and so on. And it was a punitive action. They did things like that. Because when, for example, they come into Nizhny or so, they said, if you will not open the gate, we will make the same as in Baturyn. News about destruction of Baturyn horrified and demoralized people. Many supporters of Mazepa probably seen twice before joint uprising. That's how they work with terror. They left people in the streets, and when Mazepa and Swiss come in, he said, Orlyk in his diary wrote that it was Kanuji Krovi, frozen, you know, on the streets and everywhere. There are many information other sources provide that they brought the body to the same river and put it down. Swiss information said that they making plots, planks, whatsoever, and crucified some Cossacks and put them on the same river and then going on to Desna and so to intimidate population and horrify. When they brought bodies to the same river, and that's about 200-300 meters from the fortress, some sources said that it was streams of blood to the river, and that the blood probably from Baturyn going to river. I believe that they deliver bodies there, and it was a lot of blood remained on the way. And it looks like streams of blood or rivers of blood flying from Baturyn to same river. So there definitely many bodies were still on the streets, and of course we discovered them in dwellings and nor or nearby. They were buried also there, their relatives buried there. But very soon it was very cold winter, it's coming snow. And if it comes in snow until the spring, nobody will bury them. Nor Swedes doing that. Only people who remains with Mazepa, it was not all of them were from Baturyn, but many, they come in and should bury the body of relatives, and they definitely do that. Whatever we discover, it was buried body. Of course, very quickly and in a war situation and so on and so on. Because Swedes don't stay in Baturyn, they follow, they continue that trip. So, Mazepa definitely was in Baturyn because he looks for some his treasures. He still keeping Baturyn and he take it away with him. When new settlers coming, and it was about Tanya Rozumovsky, they definitely cleaned their lots. And it was a lot of stones, bones and bones and in a mess. And skulls, we discovered them, but they are not in order, we cannot identify them. But then many of them probably take the bones to the cemeteries and bury as a mass grave. But this kind of things we discover. Yes? So, mass graves could be exist, and specialists thought that the easiest way they will put them on if they will make mass graves. For example, Mazepa troops come in and makes mass graves of these Cossacks, let us say. We don't discover Cossacks, this is just civilian, women and children, and in some cases elderly people. To put them in a mound, and from rampart to put an earth, the easiest. This is how in many cases they were. And they thought that when they will excavate completely citadel mount, it was excavated completely, you should go order that restored. They thought that they will find something, nothing there. But the line of fortification of fortress will never be mount excavated. And the specialist, Volodymyr Kovalenko, he maintained and he died in 2016. And before his death even he maintained that he said, I would like to make excavation with technique with bulldozer of the mound, and I will try to find that. So mass grave could be there.
As far as the Russians, they perish, most likely they bury them there. We have one specialist who, from Guhi archaeologist, he's very good specialist in searching in graves and so on, and monuments, remnants. He used American metal detectors, but he even adjusted it. It's even there is burnt ceramic, he can also trace it. So, and he maintained that he will find it. He actually discovered the foundation for the Orlyk residence. He believed that he will discover a place when the Russian put its battery of cannons to destroy the wall. And he, in some vicinities, he finds some Russian soldiers' batons and things like that. So there is a traces, maybe in a case that could be found. I don't think they will put them to glue his body. They should probably bury them, but they probably bury them separately. And it's easiest way to make it more in mud. So that's our guess, you know. But I can stress that we, from the very beginning in Baturyn, we're not, you can say, specialized in searching for the victims of the tragedy. We focus on the monuments and things like that. Whatever it's coming, it's coming. I will show you. It's in a fortress, many places where there were victims. But to search specifically for the, you can say, it should be specialist expert on that. He will in charge, will be in charge. He will get a grant, he will get technique, he will try to, could you imagine excavation of the mud? This is tons of earth. We have 50 or 70 people. The depths could be about mud, it's about 8 to 10 meters. According to technique, if there is deeper than 3 meters, you should put wooden reinforcement. Otherwise, students could be perished and we will be responsible. So it is a very complicated job, and instead of excavating, you can say, our traditional monuments, residents and so on, we will dig in ground without lots of finds. And we cannot risk it to excavate the whole 28 hectares area of the fortification and don't find nothing. So with our modest funds now, in the time of the war, we're happy that we still existed and we can do something. In the time of Yushchenko, when he provided substantial funding, excavation were not 21 days, how much they can give us students from Chernihiv University, working days. And with the funds, we can maintain 50, 60, 70, 18 people. And we have excavation for 2.5 months. We excavated huge Holy Trinity Cathedral. Students working for 2.5, 3 months in different groups, changing one another. That was another time. Now, time of war. And, in the 2012-2014, when it was shock of the Russian war, parents don't want to allow kids to visit, to attend our excavation. They're afraid. From Chernihiv, it's three-hour drive to Baturyn. It was still shocked. It was. Now it's better situation. I wish to stress that the visiting of Baturyn is growing. Despite of the war, last year it was 175,000, for 30,000 more than in previous year. And in the time of 2014, first year of the war, it was 130,000. And in the time of Yushchenko, it was over 210,000. So it's still aftershock, it's growing. And it gives some funds for Baturyn Preserve. They publish something, arrange conferences. It's going. It's tough about 100 people working there, with scholars, with technicians and so on. So something is we're trying to do, but some project we should postpone.
Thank you.
Any questions, please? If not, I would like again to thank you so much for your kind interest and support, and if you wish, to support Baturyn Project, which we, in a time of war, especially need. You can make a donation with a check. There is two funds. Ukrainica Research Institute and Pontifical Institute of Medieval Studies. Both of them will give you a text receipt. If you would like to make cash donation, Pontifical Institute of Medieval Studies provide this envelope, which you can find at the entrance. And you can only oblige to provide your address, because otherwise they cannot legally give you text receipt. If there is address, and if you wish to put telephone for contact, please, and you can give envelopes to me, or if this is check, you can give to me or to Mr. Stetsiv. And I also would like to thank again Mr. Stetsiv for 18 years. Of sponsoring this presentation for Community of Toronto, and actually he is also president of the Ukrainian Research Institute, the sole academic sponsor for our project. Thank you so much again. If you have private questions, please come. If you need some academic work in English and Ukrainian, because there is only newspapers basically, and some, for example, you know, like CIUS reports and so on. And I have academic work as well, and if you're specifically interested in destruction of Baturyn, I have 2 or 3 articles I can share. Thank you so much again, and I look forward to your private questions.
On behalf of all of us here this evening, I would like to sincerely thank you, Dr. Mezentsev, for an excellent lecture, highly professional in his preparation and delivered in an understandable way. For all of us to absorb, and we greatly appreciate your expertise. Thank you.
Thank you.